Dear Muslims, assalamu alaikum. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna alhamdulillahi wa nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi azza wa jal. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. We seek Allah's refuge from the rejected enemy, Satan. Praise be to Allah, the guardian evolver, the cherisher, the keeper, the sustainer of all the worlds, of all the systems of knowledge. We ask Allah's help. We ask for his mercy and his guidance. And mighty and sublime is he. I bear witness openly that there's nothing worthy of worship except Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is Allah's messenger. Prayers and peace be upon Prophet Muhammad, upon his family, upon his descendants, and upon us, the Muslim Ummah, be peace. And what follows is to the point that we are gathered today for the beautiful Jummah prayer, Jummah Salat. Dear Muslims, we are so pleased and honored again to stand before you. We can never take this duty for granted. Again, I'm happy to see you here on a beautiful day. I want to start right in with a surah from the Qur'an. This is Surah 30, Ayat 23, which is the basis of this lecture. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ مَنَامُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَابْتِغَاؤُكُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَسْمَعُونَ. And among his signs is the sleep that you take by night and by day, and the quest that you make for livelihood out of his bounty. And verily in that are signs for those who hearken. Sadaqallahu al-Azim, surely the mighty Allah speaks the truth. Dear Muslims, what would life be without sleep? Without deep, restful, and abiding sleep? So we know that the world is quite deficient in sleep. This is what the doctor says, the medical doctor. He says most of us are sleep deprived. Why? This is a question. So we're ever running, forever running, to get things done. One thing stacked on another, on top of another, expending great time and energy. For what? To make a livelihood. Now, that means different things to different people. For some, they spend a great deal of time and energy doing things that are non-constructive, and a great deal of energy working against you and me. Now, I assume that we are Muslim up in here, and that we are about the business of producing justice in ourselves and in the world around us. And there are many people who spend their energy attacking that effort. So how are we using our energy, and towards what end? And Allah is always giving us signs in the Qur'an and in the Revelation and in the world around us. Signs and symbols, guidance and warnings of the how best we need to move in the world. How to guide our thought, our speech, and our action to live this life in our most beautiful way. And one such sign of that is the sleep we take. So we don't much think too much about sleep. I mean, we don't really think too much about it. We just do what we have to do, and when we get tired, we fall off. You drift on off at the end of a day of work, maybe. And the truth is that sleep is very, very important to our existence. We sleep so much of our life, and we say, sleep it away. Well, maybe some people sleep it away. But if we're judicious about our sleep, we're not sleeping our life away. We're restoring ourselves. We're recovering from the work that we've been doing. And when we sleep, we're really not present in these bodies of ours, or at least we don't seem to be. Spiritually, mentally, we're in another place, a whole entirely another place, and our bodies are laying wherever we drop them. So in this verse, Allah is saying this sleep is being taken by night and by day. And Allahu alam, Allah knows the best what these verses or ayat mean. But Allah has also obligated us to peer into this message and to comprehend it, to be aware of it for ourselves and for our families, for our communities. So we go into the world and we see in Allah's bounty the substantial gifts that Allah has placed around us in the whole entire universe. the entire universe. This is not suitland. As far as our eyes can see, we see nothing but beauty. We see nothing but bounty. And the word here is used is fadlihi, which is translated as abundance. Abundance. Extreme abundance. All of this is being placed at our disposal so that we can dress our life, so that we can engage in a lively activity. And we all have work to do. We choose the work we do. And the word livelihood here in this translation is actually added by the translator, just to give it a little bit of familiarity for the English speaker. But I do agree with his adding that word because it helps to understand what this fadlihi is being used for. So we are expending this time and this energy to bring Allah's gifts into our life in the pursuit of happiness. And you know that language, right? That's the language of the Constitution. The pursuit of happiness. And the pursuit of happiness for some people is taqwa. We're familiar with that term too, right? Taqwa. That's believing in Allah and behaving as though Allah is right there, because certainly Allah is witnessing and is in command of every iota of space. But there are more feeble attempts at livelihood around us. People trying to live the best they know. And some, as I had mentioned, they expend their energy at the expense of other people, at the expense of the righteous. And so they are, in fact, to the degree that they are doing that, they are misusing Allah's bounty. The translation reads, "Verily in that fact are signs for those who hearken." Now I added the word fact. You probably picked that up. "Are those who hearken." So that's an old English word. We don't use that word anybody. I haven't said, Akbar, hearken this, brother. I haven't used that word in a while. But we translate this stuff pretty quickly. So in my own reflection, I translated that so I could comprehend it. In that are instructing guidance for those people who are actively listening, not passively, active. And certainly Allah, as I had mentioned, Allah knows the truth of these things. But we as Muslims are actively reading. We're actually reading Allah's signs all the time, whether it's in the Qur'an or some other scripture or in the world at large. We are actively listening and looking and making connections to improve ourselves and to improve our communities. So Allah again says we sleep by night and by day. Yes, we tend to sleep. So in our jobs, I might have a night job where I sleep during the day. Or I might have a day job where I sleep during the night. But there, as you might realize, there's a second reading to all of this. Second reading. And the day may be understood to be the arrival of knowledge, the arrival of light, whereas the night may be understood as a time of ignorance, a time of lacking, be lacking. And so what connection do we see between these ideas? So simply put, the light brings constructive activity. In the same way, the sun, when the sun comes up at dawn, it brings up the vegetation. And you don't see it maybe, but the plants track the sun. When the sun comes up, they move in the direction of the sun. The leaves, and then they follow the sun all the way across the heaven. Yes, that's live. Them plants are awake and receptive for the light. Ethics, right thinking, knowledge and intelligence bring life to a dead mind, and by consequence, to a dead society, and the darkness brings death. Weakness, wickedness, corruption, wrong thinking, ignorance, stupidity, neglect, these things kill the mind and kill the world we live in, kill the society we live in. So Jabir ibn Abdullah reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, "O Messenger of Allah, do the people of paradise sleep?" And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Sleep is the sister of death, and the people of paradise do not sleep." And in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Sleep is the brother of death, and the people of paradise do not die." And this is a sahih or authentic, has been judged to be an authentic hadith. So dear people, now we start seeing sleep and death being compared here. So we're going in a different vein now. We're still talking about sleep. And in this next ayat, in Zumar 39:42, Allah says, "Allahu yatawaffal anfusa hina mautiha wallati lam ta'mut fi manamiha fayumliku allati fadda alayha موتى ولا يرسلون أخرى إلا أجل مسمى إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون." It is Allah that takes the souls at death, and those that die not during their sleep, and those on whom he's passed the decree of death, he keeps back from returning to life, but the rest he sends to their bodies for a term appointed. And verily in this are signs for those who reflect, who think, who got the lights turned on upstairs. Dear brothers and sisters, this connects death and sleep, sleep and death. So we hear that sleep is a brother or sister of death, and we think of kinship. So sleep is akin to death, in that in both states, we lose consciousness. We lose our wakefulness. We lose consciousness. We're not hearing. We're not seeing, we're not feeling, tasting, or smelling in the ways that we do while we're awake. So in the vernacular, we say we're out of it. That's what the doctor says when they put you down or out. Now, I just recently had a procedure, and it never ceases to amaze me what happens when they put you under sedation. Because one minute you're awake, and they put that solution in you, and you wake up 2 hours later, and it's as though one instant has passed. And many of you have experienced that. And that's a sign for us. That's a very powerful sign for us. And so, yeah, we might say when we're sleeping, we're out of it. And so we walk down Martin Luther King Avenue or maybe Suitland Road, and we see that a lot of people out of it. stumbling around, bumbling around, breaking in people's cars or what have you. And we see that a lot of people on Wall Street and on Capitol Hill that are similarly asleep, they done lost their consciousness. They done lost their mind. And they're doing things that hinder the life, the human excellence that we were created out of and into. And then we see the shows on that Hollywood produces, and we see titles like Walking Dead. Oh yeah, they're making a little joke. They're making a joke about us. They're laughing at us in our ignorance. And in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, Ayah 41, Allah says, "Inna anzalna alaykal kitaba lilnasi bilhaq. Famanith tadda fali nafsihi wa man dalla fa innama yudillu alayha wa ma anta alayhim biwakid. Verily we have revealed the book to you in truth for instructing mankind. He then that receives guidance receives it for his own soul, but he that strays injures his own soul, and nor are you set over them to dispose of their affairs." Alhamdulillah, Allah has given us guidance, and Allah is painting a picture here for us to see. We have so many diverse forms of guidance coming at us from the Quran and from other forms of revelation and from just the nature itself. Nature herself are guides for the instructing of the human life to guide us back to the original nature, the fitra nature that we were created out of. Human excellence, that's the word. Human excellence, that's what we were born for. We were excellent infants. And look at us now. The infant is aware. The infant is absorbing knowledge at a tremendous rate. And then we get sidetracked. We get sidetracked. And Allah says in the Quran, "لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ." We have indeed created the human being in the best mold. Ahsani taqweem, that's human excellence. It's our inheritance to be excellent. And who gets it? Those get it who are wide awake, who are receptive to the message. Awake to the reality of the existence of our Almighty Allah. And the very next verse we read, "Thumma radadnahu asfala safilin." Then we do abase him to be the lowest of the low. Now, do we think Allah wants the human being to be low? No, indeed. No, indeed. But this creation is set up as a just creation. And what you put out comes right back. So these are uninformed people. People who are ignorant. People who are in the dark. Maybe they're just not listening. Or maybe they are, as I mentioned, people who are in open rebellion. They heard the message. They know the truth. They know they're doing wrong. But they do it anyway. And in this translation, Yusuf Ali says that he that strays injures his own soul. So this is a person whose sleep even though the daylight is in front of him. Sleep in the middle of the day. When the guidance is all around him, he's got his blindfolds on. Sleep. Dear believers, isn't it better for us to sleep at night? And Allah says in the Qur'an further, in another place, in An-Naml, the B, ayah 86, Alam taraw anna ja'alna layla liyaskunu fihi wa nahara mubsiran inna fi dhalika la ayatin liqawmin yu'minun. And see they not that we have made the night for them to rest in, and the day to give them light? And verily, in this are signs for any people, any person that believe. So we see the likeness in this story of the last time I talked about the sleepers in the cave, Surah 18, the cave, Al-Kahf. And Allah caused them to sleep through a period of great chaos and turmoil. And then Allah woke them up, caused them to be woke up, and asked them, hey, how long have you tarried? They couldn't tell. Just like me when they put me out for the procedure, they woke me up. Have y'all started yet? It's over. You've been in there 2 hours, man. I didn't know. And neither did the sleepers. And it just so happens that I was in Jordan recently. And I went to a place that they said was where the sleepers were. Where the locals there was like, I'm not sure about that. So there are many places where people claim that the sleepers, that cave is. But I went to one of them. Thank Allah. So during times of ignorance, times of foolishness, times when bad stuff is going down, if we are right-minded, we should be asleep to that mess. We should be at home somewhere. We should not be in the club with Beyonce or Jay-Z or whoever else is out there right now. I mean, I don't want to down their music or anything, but I'm saying there's a time for that, maybe. Maybe. We need our own music. So we don't want our families, we don't want our wives, we don't want our children awake to foolishness. We want them to sleep in the night. And we want to be asleep in the night. We want to awake to human excellence. We want to awake to the elevation of the human spirit. And sleep to that degrading nature that Satan has in store. And so when after all of the work that we put in, they still want to be fools, derelict, and rebellious, Allah says, we're not set over them to dispose of their affairs. Not at all. And so that's what the old folks used to say, my grandfather, all of them. You made your bed? Y'all know how that ends, right? You lie in it. And they right there. You made it, you lie in it. But Allah doesn't want that for us. Not at all. And in Al-Furqan, Surah 25, Ayah 47, Allah says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا وَالنَّوْمَ سُبَاتًا وَجَعَلَ النَّهَارَ نُشُورًا. And it is He who makes the night as a robe for you and the sleep as repose and makes the day as it were a resurrection. Think about that. That's a wonderful idea that we are resurrected every morning. From what? From sleep. from repose. When we think of a robe, we think of something nice and comfortable, right? Maybe terry cloth. Maybe from one of them hotels or something. No, mashallah. I don't have one of those at home, but they have them in the hotels. And the sleep here is described as rest. It's subatan, from the same word that when you hear people talk about a sabbatical, that kind of rest, or the Sabbath in the Jewish tradition, they say the Sabbath. That's the same word. It's rest. It's al-nom subatan. It's a restful sleep. The law makes the night as a robe for us. All that stuff's going on outside, you go to sleep like one of them bears in the wintertime. Go on, get in the cave and go to sleep. And then you wake up. It's the arrival of guidance, a new day, a resurrection, in fact. It's a dead life coming back to life, a dead person coming back to life, maybe. So if we can imagine 8 billion people, which is almost what it is now, all of them got to sleep, and everybody got a resurrection day every morning. That's a rather nice thought. So terror and tragedy, which we've seen a lot of lately, that's not something we want for ourselves or our families. We want to be awake, pursuing time and energy to have a wonderful livelihood. We say, Hayya ala salah. Come lively to prayer. Come lively to salat. Hayya ala falah. Come lively to success. Falah, like growing something. That plant comes up out of hardship into the light. Come lively to success. So we woke into Fajr prayer, alhamdulillah. And in the morning adhan, you know it's different than the other adhan, right? How is it different? As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm. Prayer is better than sleep. So now we went connecting sleep to death, and death and sleep to prayer. Prayer is better than sleep. It's better to be alive than dead. It's better to be glorifying Allah than to be on your back. And our sleep nourishes us. It nourishes our bodies. And prayer nourishes our soul. Prayer nourishes our innards, our mind, our soul, our heart. And Allah indeed reminds us that prayer is the best thing in life, if you only could recognize that. And we say, remember Allah, and Allah will remember us. So, dear believers, sleep is a wonderful thing. Allah created us to sleep, to rest our tired bodies. And Allah has given us the salat as a form of rest. A form of resting within Allah. And Allah says in Al-Muzammil, O thou folded in garments, stand to pray by night, but not all of the night, half of it or a little less, or a little more, and recite the Qur'an in slow and measured tones, and soon we shall send down to you a weighty message. And truly the rising by night is a most potent form of governing the soul and most suitable for framing the word. True, there is for you a day prolonged occupation with ordinary duties, but keep in remembrance the name of your Lord and devote yourself to him wholeheartedly. Dear Muslims, the rising by night from sleep to perform the tahajjud is difficult, but as we see here in the Quran, it is advised. We need to govern our soul. The great thinker, the great Muslim mind, the teacher called Imam Warith Uddin Muhammad, a mujaddid. I say he was a mujaddid from these shores. Right here in what we used to call the hells of North America, he was raised to speak to a blind, deaf, dumb, asleep people. And he said something that lit a spark in us. We lit a spark in the Muslim livelihood in these United States of America. And it's reverberated around the world now. He said, man means mind. And woman means womb of mind. And with that idea, he introduced us to the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And like magic, it began to raise us. It pulled us out of a sleep state. Now, these are people who were killed for 400 years. Our best inclinations were snuffed, or we were put in a deep sleep. And we got the message, a clarion call to become awake, awake to this deen of fitra, awake to the Quran, awake to the way, awake to the message of the Quran. Come alive, human being. Come alive to dignity. Stop sleeping on your job. Stop sleeping to the dignity of work. We pray with our eyes open, dear believers. It's not just a ritual. It means much more. It's a practice. And with a practice, we do a thing so we get better at it. And with every prayer, we should be launching ourselves into the future. So our prayer is awareness. A prayer pushes us towards taqwa, an extreme form of awareness. We say when we pray to Allah, Allah hears us. Allah hears us from wherever we are in the universe. Prayer is action. So when we get up from our prayer, when we get up from our worship, we leave and we go out into the world and we establish what we have been asking Allah for, what we were dreaming about in our sleep. And now that we're awake, we're asking Allah, pleading with Allah to give us the mind, the weighty message to go out and establish the world that we know this thing could be. Aren't you a little bit tired of it? This okey-doke we're in? These sleepwalking people guiding us. How? No, dead people guiding us. Don't make no sense. So, dear believers, Allah says, and I'm going to wrap up here quickly. He said the key to paradise is prayer. And the key to prayer is wudu. We can't come to prayer foul. We got to clean up. When we wake up from a restorative sleep, we have to do wudu, make wudu. And we can't make wudu with filthy water. We have to have pure water. This is also a sign for us. Dear believers, this happiness that we pursue, the taqwa, the union with Allah, the attempt to get closer to Allah, this is something that is a noble goal for all of us. We need to bring ourselves, our families into it, and vanquish and wash away the bitterness, the iniquity, the envy and jealousy that we have between us. And with this, I will stop here and bring the second part, inshallah. As-salatu as-salamu ala rasulihi kareem amma ba'd. So dear Muslims, taqwa is our aim. Taqwa is our aim. Taqwa is our aim. An extreme awareness, quite contrary to the sleep state, an extreme awareness and closeness to Allah. So when we took the Shahada, all of us took the Shahada, we made a declaration. And we chose to be a wide awake man and a wide awake woman. We chose to help break the bonds, free the hands and feet of those who can't fend for themselves. We chose to help the people most who need the most help. If you didn't know that, now you do. That's what we chose to do, starting with our own self and our own family. Let us fulfill the covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah always fulfills his promise to us. Let us love one another with the love that only Allah could give. Let us establish this deen in our own life and in the life around us, in our communities, in this nation, and in the world. Let's remake this world into what it should be. So dear Muslims, with that, I'm going to read some announcements, inshallah, and then we'll make salat. So we are continuing to progress here at the Ali Khan Islamic Center. We are trying to secure this property. We've got cameras hung now. We're going to be putting a different type of lock on the, on the masjid. And inshallah, if everything works like we like it to, you will have access to this place, even when we're not here. Those of you who want access, we will be trying to give access to the people who want to pray here. So please support us in what we're trying to do. This is Allah's house. It doesn't belong to any of us, but we are custodians of this house. And inshallah, we're going to try to make it a proper facility, a proper masjid. Please do not forget your Muslim Journal newspaper. Maybe only one article in the paper will hit your interest this week, but get it anyway. But I'm sure that there's more than one article there. See Imam. Noble Imam Hamza Abdul Hamid, be on your way out. Please patronize the snack table, bean pies, and other snacks. And I wanted to announce that the boxing program has started. So we have Brother Najee. Where is Najee? Oh, there he is, back in the back. Najee was a professional boxer. If you did not know that, they called him Lloyd Honeyboy Taylor. And he was putting people to sleep. No, he was knocking them out. He fought 29 fights, 17 he won by knockout, another 3 by technical knockout. He fought about 136 rounds in his career. And he's here with us. He came in off the street, like many of us did. And he's a contributor to this place now. He's trying to make this place better. And we thank Allah for him, and we should support him. So we have sent a schedule out for the khatibs for this for the Jummah through Ramadan, and we're planning the other events of Ramadan, the Ramadan session, the Laylatul Qadr, and the Eid al-Fitr. And we've announced that our beloved Imam Talib Deen Uqda Talib Abdul Deen Uqda. Talib Deen Abdul Uqda will be the khatib for the Eid al-Fitr this year. So please keep your ears out for any news about Ramadan, because it's coming quickly and we love it. It's the arrival of light, dawn, coming again. The Muslim American Logic Institute is now scheduled to have their annual Arabic conference at Masjid Allah in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania on Friday, June 28th, 29th, and 30th. Please get your tickets, go online, Eventbrite, type in Quranic conference, and you should see that event. The registration is $45 for children, 17 and under, and $100 for everyone else. On May 5th, at the Dianet Center, there's an event that reads the following. Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you. You are invited to the first annual Uniting the Ummah of Islamic Conference. The theme is Closing the Gap. And this is being hosted by Brother Yahya Muhammad. And it's going to be dealing with conflict resolution in our community, again, at the Dianet Center. Our beloved Imam, Imam Al-Hajj Sultan Muhammad Abdullah will be speaking there, and we'll be looking forward to that. So, dear people, that's the end of my lecture and the presentation. Akima Tazlat. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawmideen, Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Ihdina Sirata Al-Mustaqeem, Sirata Al-Ladhina An'amta Alayhim, Ghayri Al-Maghdubi Alayhim, Wala Dalin. Inna atayna kalkawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shaniyaka huwa al-abtar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu liman hamida. Allahu Akbar. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. قل أعوذ برب الفلق min shari ma qalaq wa min shari ghasikin idha waqab wa min shari nafathati fil uqad wa min shari hasidin idha hasad. Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas, malikin nas, ilakin nas, min shari waswasil kannas alladhi yuwaswisu fi sudurin nas min al-jannati wan-nas. Allahu akbar. Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Allahu akbar. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum
wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Takbir!
Allahu akbar! Takbir!
Allahu
akbar!
Takbir!
Yeah. You gotta stay awake.